Welcome to Gurukul Live Lectures. Today we will be continuing with the recombinant DNA technology sessions in the biotechnology series that is going on. We'll be taking up cloning vectors 2, and the learning objective specifically for this particular session would be to study the characteristics of cloning vectors based on the E. coli plasmids. We will also talk about the M13 bacteriophage based cloning vectors. And we will also study the lambda bacteriophage cloning vectors. So, we talked about the different, what are the cloning vectors, why for recombinant DNA technology we need these cloning vehicles, because whatever gene of interest we have, if we want to express it, if we want to clone it, if we want to amplify it in E. coli, then we need to introduce it into E. coli. And for these cloning vehicles are used. Now, these cloning vectors can be derived from a number of things, which is basically the plasmids, the bacteriophages, etc. And there are other eukaryotic vectors also, the bacterial artificial chromosomes or, the higher capacity vectors, which we will be taking in our subsequent sessions. So, today our concentration would be to understand the cloning vectors derived from the E. coli plasmids, the M13 bacteriophages and the lambda bacteriophages. Now, we also talked about in our previous session the importance of plasmids as the cloning vectors. We talked about certain attributes, which is basically that it is a smaller in size, it has a high copy number, it has an origin of replication that enables it to replicate into a different host. Then there is a vector selection phenomena, and there is a recombinant selection phenomena. These are the certain ideal features which a cloning vector should have. So, we start with basically these are the references, which is T.A. Brown and the R.M. Twyman. These two references have been explicitly used in this particular session, and this is only used for the educational purpose. So, talking about the cloning vectors based on E. coli plasmids, the nomenclature of plasmid cloning vectors, if we start with, they are generally named as, for example, PBR322. It conforms with the standard rules for vector nomenclature, which is that in all the plasmid vectors, we have got this P, which indicates that this is indeed a plasmid. Then the capital BR, for example, in this particular case, identifies the laboratory in which the vector was originally constructed. In here, the BR stands for the Baldwin and Rodericks, the two researchers who developed the PBR322. So, BR basically refers to, for example, you must have heard of a very prevalent cloning vector, which is PUC. So, in that, the P stands for the plasmid and UC stands for the University of California, where the plasmid was discovered. So, the BR or UC or different kind of such annotations basically refer to the researchers or the lab where it has been developed. Now, coming to number 322, this distinguishes this plasmid from other developed in the same laboratory. For example, there are other plasmids such as PBR325, 327, 328, etc., which have been discovered or constructed by the same lab. So, they are referred to as these numbers which are put at the end of the plasmid, as well as the identification of the lab in which this was constructed. So, this is a general nomenclature which is being followed for the naming of different plasmids. Now, we'll talk about an important plasmid which is PBR322. Now, this is the series which started with, we are just taking an example of, for example, the E. coli based plasmids which we are talking about. So, you can see this is the map of PBR322, and in this PBR322, the main aspects of its utility are because it is very small in size. It carries two sets of antibiotic resistance gene for vector selection and recombinant selection. Now, if you remember, we talked about an ideal cloning vector should have a very good vector selection marker and a recombinant selection marker. I just review that again, that vector selection is basically when you introduced your recombinant vector into a host, then you need to have a selectable marker which can identify the host cells that contain the vector from the host cells that do not contain the vector. We don't want to grow the vector, the host cells which do not contain a vector, because it is of no use for us, but still it will be utilizing all the resources. So, we put a selectable marker so that only the vector introduced cells, host cells, grow. That is basically the vector selection marker. Now, we are interested actually not only the vector but the recombinant vector. Now, because this is recombinant DNA technology where the hybrid of two different DNAs coming from two different sources are maintained, then we also need that there is a possibility that the vector recircularizes when we ligate the gene of interest into the vector. Now, it becomes a vector, it can be introduced into the host cell, but it is no use for us because it is not a recombinant vector. So, we need to have a marker which gives us the recombinant selection so that only those host cells, or we can identify those cells which contain a vector containing our gene of interest and not just the circularized vector. That is called as the recombinant selection, and we also discussed in a last session the one of the selection method, which is basically the blue white screening. So, this PBR322, it carried two sets of antibiotic resistant genes for which the vector selection and the recombinant selection which were there. Then it also had a reasonably high copy number. We again talked about that the plasmid to be an ideal cloning vector should have a high copy number. Copy number is the number of copies of a plasmid present in a particular cell. So, higher the copy number, you know, there are more, from a single cell you can isolate a large number of vectors containing your gene of interest. So, that is important for the plasmids to have the high copy number for cloning. I mean, there are certain exceptions where you need a low copy number, but in generally for the cloning purpose, you need to have a reasonably high copy number. So, PBR322 comprises DNA derived from three different naturally occurring plasmids. So, how does this plasmid? So, I again want to emphasize here that there are certain plasmids which are naturally occurring plasmids. You know, naturally occurring plasmids, you construct them or you modify them, you manipulate them to become a good cloning vector. Our purpose is to clone a gene of interest or to insert a gene of interest into this vector so that it can be introduced into a suitable host. Now, for that purpose, usually naturally occurring plasmids are not ideal cloning vectors. So, we manipulate them. For example, this BBR322 was constructed by containing, you know, three different sources. So, it had three different sources from where the construction was done. So, we can see here that the ampicillin resistant gene originally resided on the plasmid R1, a typical antibiotic resistance plasmid that occurs in natural population of E. coli. So, basically this ampicillin resistant gene is coming from the R1 plasmid, this particular fragment. This ampicillin resistant gene is a very common vector selection marker. So, the cells which contain this vector will be ampicillin resistant, whereas the cells which do not contain the vector will be ampicillin sensitive. So, if we put ampicillin in the medium, then only those cells will grow which contain the vector. So, this becomes an important vector selection marker, and in PBR322, this is coming from the vector plasmid R1. The tetracycline resistant gene. Now, this PBR322 contains two resistant genes. Another one, which is called as the tetracycline resistant gene, is derived from another vector, which is the RS5, which is a second antibiotic resistant plasmid. Now, this resistant plasmid is, you can see this particular fragment is coming from this particular plasmid. Now, the origin of replication, as you can see, is coming from a third fragment, which is from the PMB1, which is closely related to the colocene producing plasmid Coli1. So, this particular origin of replication is coming from a different plasmid, which is the PMB1. So, you can see that PBR322 is constructed by using these three different fragments, and these three different fragments are conferring the properties on the PBR322 so that it becomes a good cloning vector. Although we are studying this to understand the basis of how the cloning vectors work, or what are the cloning vectors of E. coli plasmids, derived plasmids are there. Otherwise, there are n number of plasmids or cloning vectors that exist, and lot many manipulations have been done. They have been customized just to suit a particular role. We are just talking about the basis of how this can be constructed and what are the ideal things that they should have. So, PBR322 is not in much use now, but still, you know, that is how the construction takes place, and that is how we go on putting the things, different things into it, which are beneficial for us. Therefore, you know, the PBR 327 came into being. Now, PBR 327 was produced by removing a 1089 base pair segment from PBR 322. So, in PBR 322, this particular break went. So, that's how the series of vectors come in, you know, which is advantageous in one aspect or the another, or which is customized to suit our need, which is there. So, one of the important thing is molecular cloning, that we want to create recombinant DNA technology, so that we need to have to clone our gene of interest, to have more copies of our gene of interest. But there can be other functions also. For example, we need to express a particular gene. So, we need expression vectors for that. We need to clone a particular gene in one organism, and then we want to shift it into an entirely different organism. So, we need shuttle vectors for them. So, you know, that way all different kind of vectors based upon our functional requirements as well as the attributes which makes it an ideal cloning vector, they are constructed in series. So, this particular deletion of 1089 base pairs in PBR322 left the ampicillin resistant and tetracycline resistant genes intact, but changed the replicative and conjugative abilities of the resulting plasmid. So, this was again very important, you know, PBR322 was a okay plasmid, but okay cloning vector, but when this particular change was done, it became a better cloning vector. How? We will see. So, what happened was that in PBR327, it had a much higher copy number than the PBR322, being present at about 30 to 45 molecules per E. coli cell. It makes this vector more suitable if the aim of the experiment is to study the function of the cloned gene. So, if we want to clone a gene into a particular vector to study its function, to study its expression, or to talk about the, you know, we want to amplify it to a larger extent, as I said, high copy number is preferred. So, this PBR327, because of the deletion of that particular fragment, you know, the copy number increased from 10 to 12 to 30 to 45 molecules per E. coli. So, that was again, you know, it is getting better and it was much more advantageous. The second point was that the deletion also destroyed the conjugative ability of PBR322, making PBR327 a non-conjugative plasmid. This is again important for biological containment. What do we mean by that? That because of the conjugation, you know, it can just escape. We are doing all the manipulations in the in vitro and we are just not working with a single E. coli or with single host. So, you know, there is a possibility that because of the conjugation that might occur, the plasmids can transfer from one host to another. Now, if we are dealing with a normal gene, then it's all right. But if we are dealing with any kind of a pathogenic gene, or we are studying any kind of a, you know, some has some kind of a lethality or something, if we are doing that, then it is very important that if the conjugation ability is destroyed, then that vector is not able to pass on from any other host or to any other host, resulting in what is called as the biological containment. So, this averts the possibility of a recombinant PBR327 molecule escaping from the test tube and colonizing bacteria in the gut of the careless molecular biologist. So, it can transfer to any of the species which is in the lab. It can also transfer to a careless, you know, the gut of the molecular biologist, and it can be pathogenic, it can be containing the gene which is not good, or, you know, it can create unnecessary manipulations which we don't want. So, to contain that, the conjugative abilities are also disabled in PBR327 and it becomes a non-harmful vector. Now, we look at again a development which is the PUC8 vector. Now, PUC8 is derived or descended from PBR322, although only the replication of origin and the ampicillin resistant gene remain. So, further manipulations was done to PBR322. Now, remember that PBR322 contains two antibiotic resistant genes. So, it basically needed two-step vector selection. We have already talked about that. So, vector can be selected by, for example, ampicillin resistant, but the recombinant selection, you will have to have those cells which contain. So, replicas need to be made. It is a two-step process. You first select the cells which are ampicillin resistant, and then you select the cells which are both ampicillin and tetracycline resistant, and that way you can do the cloning part. But in Puckett, again, you know, it became a better thing because in it, only the replication origin and the ampicillin-resistant gene remain. The nucleotide sequence of the ampicillin-resistant gene has been changed so that it no longer contains the unique restriction sites. All these cloning sites are now clustered into a short segment of the delta lac-z gene, which was now carried by the Puckett. Now, this is again very important. As I told you, we are making a series so that the better the cloning vector a plasmid can become. So, in this particular case, what they did was, in earlier, there was a cloning site which was present in the ampicillin resistant gene. So, there was acting as a vector selection and a recombinant selection marker. Now, what they have done is that this ampicillin resistant gene do not contain any cloning site. So, it just basically acts for the vector selection. You have a separate cluster which is contained inside a delta lac-z gene. Now, delta lac-z gene is basically a fragment of the beta galactosidase, which you know, which is a part of the lacoperon, if you remember. Then, therefore, this particular gene is now inserted into Puckett. So, you can see this is the map of the Puckett, and in the Puckett now this ampicillin resistant gene is there. There is an origin of replication. So, this part is coming from the PBR327, and then this lac-z gene is now inserted into it. This lac-z gene contains a cluster of restriction endonucleases. If you remember, and if you go back to the ideal cloning vector attributes, then one of the it was that it contains a multiple cloning site or a polylinker sites, because that makes it versatile to take up different kind of cloned fragments, one thing. Second thing, it also enables it to do a double digestion. If we digest with the two different enzymes, then the insert is inserted in a particular orientation also. So, directional cloning can also be done. So, it is very advantageous to have different multiple cloning sites, because then it increases the repertoire of a particular vector to insert different kinds of fragments. So, as you can see that in this PUC8, this particular polylinker sites were introduced, and they were introduced into this lac-z gene. Now, this again was, you know, conferring a very, very important attribute, which is a very good thing for the vector selection. Now, what happens here is that this lac-z gene produces beta galactosidase, which gives a blue color with a particular substrate. If you remember, we talked about this kind of a blue-white screening. So, if a gene of interest is there, then this lac-z will be disrupted and there will be no more formation of the beta galactosidase fragment, and therefore there will be no more substrate you know, change into or substrate to produce the blue color. Therefore, the recombinant colonies will be only a white in color. So, that makes very easy, and this becomes just a one step process, because you just, you know, do the ligation, you do the transformation with the recombinant vectors, and you plate it on a plate containing the ampicillin resistant gene for the vector selection, as well as XGAL and IBTG, as we talked about, for the blue white screening to select the recombinant selection. So, just in one step, you are able to identify the cells containing the recombinant thing. So, PUC8, again review that there are three important advantages. First advantage, again, what one of the advantage was that due to a chance mutation that occurred within this origin of replication, the plasmid copy number increased to 500 to 700 even before amplification. So, even before you kind of grew the cells so that the number of cells increased, the copy number was 500 to 7. So, if you remember PBR 32, 10 to 12, PBR 327, it was 35 to 40, and now PUC8 has around 500 to 700 copy number, which is therefore, you know, even before amplification, you can have so many number of copies of your recombinant vector to have more of your gene of interest. So, this was a very important advantage that the PUC8 conferred. Then this has a significant effect on the yield of cloned DNA, as I said, obtainable from E. coli cells transformed with recombinant PUC8 plasmids. The second important advantage was that the identification of recombinant cells can be achieved by a single step process. So, as I was explaining, you do not have to grow them into ampicillin, you have to pick them up and then grow them into tetracycline. It is a two step process involving the replica plating, so that you can finally identify the cells which were both ampicillin and tetracycline resistant, and therefore can be the recombinant containing the recombinant plasmid. For Parquet, you just need one step process. You just ligate, you transform, and then you plate the cells on a medium plate containing ampicillin for the vector selection, plus this particular substrate which is XCAL and the inducer IBTG, and you will get a blue-white screening thing. So you will have blue colonies and white colonies. Blue colonies will be the one where the LAGZ gene is not disrupted, it is not containing the insert, whereas if it is disrupted, there will be white colonies in it. So again, a very large advantage for using the Parquet thing. The third important advantage was that Parquet lies with the clustering of the restriction sites, which allows a DNA fragment with two different sticky ends, for example, say EcoR1 to be and BAMH1 to be cloned without resorting to additional manipulations such as linker attachment. We will talk about these kind of manipulations such as linker attachment a little later. But this particular point I want to emphasize here, which I just explained, that if you have a multiple cloning site, if you have a polylinker site, then it becomes easier to digest one insert with two different restriction enzymes and clone it into the vector. So that gives an advantage of one, the directional cloning, which is important for the expression of certain genes if one wants to do. So there has to be a promoter, and next to it you have to have the fragment in a particular orientation. So you can digest it with two different restriction enzymes and insert it into a digested vector. So there will be a directional cloning. So Parquet has these three major advantages that it became a very important vector. However, other PUC vectors carry different combination of restriction sites and provide even greater flexibility in the types of DNA fragment that can be cloned. For example, you can see this is PUC18. PUC18 and PUC19, the only difference is that in PUC19, this orientation is reversed. The PUC18 and PUC19 are the most used cloning vectors derived from the E. coli plasmids. They are very versatile, very useful. You can see that this LAGZ gene has these kind of, you know, further more restriction sites are introduced into it. And because of these restriction sites, a large number of diverse fragments, you know, digested with different restriction enzymes can be inserted into PUC18 and 19. It is a small plasmid, it can carry up to 5 to 10 kb, although towards 5 to 6 kb, 10 is a higher number, but still it can contain that much amount of insert DNA which can be there. So these other PUC vectors are also derived from the PUC8 vectors which are there. So that is an important, so we talked about these E. coli derived plasmids, but that was in relation to preferably talking about the cloning of a gene of interest. Cloning here basically we means the increase in the copies of that particular gene of interest. But sometimes what we want to do is a functional manipulation also. That is, we want that the cloned DNA should be transcribed. It should produce an RNA. There are n number of reasons which we for which we want to do that. We want to have the probe. You know, we want to have the RNA fragment so that we can create a probe for that, or we want to do the in vitro mutagenesis, which we talk about in molecular biology. So all these kind of manipulations, we also need vectors that can actually express the cloned DNA or that can in vitro transcribe also to give the particular RNA. So for that thing, I just talk about this particular example, which is PGM3Z. So this is one of the examples. This is very similar to a PUC vector. It carries the ampicillin resistant and the LAGZ gene, which we talk about, the latter containing the cluster. So it has this multiple you know, cloning site or a polylinker site which is there. So it is almost exactly the same size. So the backbone is similar to the PUC which we have been talking about. Now you can see there are two important things lying here. One is the, you know, these two different promoters which are there, the T7 promoters and SP6 promoter. So this is very important because these two additional short pieces of DNA, each of which act as the recognition site for the attachment of an RNA polymerase enzyme. These two promoter sequence lie on either side of the cluster of restriction sites used by the introduction of new DNA into the PGM3Z molecule. So the cloning basically occurs just like what we do for the PUC. So we clone, we digest the restriction and digest with, you know, I'm going to elaborate the mechanism of recombinant DNA technology a little later. Right now, we are just concentrating on talking about the different vectors. But the basic mechanism of recombinant DNA cloning is that you cut it with different restriction enzymes, you ligate them together, you introduce it into a host and let it multiply with the host. So, when you have to introduce your gene of interest in here, you will cut it with the restriction enzymes, you will introduce, you will ligate them here. Now, when the gene of interest is ligated here, now you have these two different kind of promoters. These two promoters act as the attachment sites for the RNA polymerase. So, the RNA polymerase can attach here and transcribe through the gene of interest, creating or making the RNA molecule of the gene of interest. So, the transcription of cloned DNA can occur because you have got these two important promoters cloned here. So, this is very important. If a recombinant PGM3Z molecule is mixed with purified RNA polymerase in vitro, the transcription occurs and RNA copies of the cloned fragment are synthesized. So, in vitro amplification can be done. You can take the recombinant plasmid, you can introduce the enzymes, the purified RNA polymerase in vitro and obviously the DNTPs, etc. and the transcription of the cloned DNA can take place. And this, as I said, is very important because the RNA that is produced could be used as a hybridization probe or for experiments aimed at studying RNA processing, for example, the removal of introns or the protein synthesis. So, varied kind of functions are important for the RNA that is produced from the cloned fragment. So, sometimes the expression is important. Sometimes the expression is important in vivo also, within the host cell, the vectors, for example, there are a lot of factors which are vectors such as PGX, or there are other vectors which contain different kind of tags which are there. So, what happens is when the gene of interest is transcribed and the proteins are formed, then those proteins, so that happens in vivo, you are not transcribing the cloned DNA. You are just introducing the cloned DNA into the vector and that vector is causing the gene to be transcribed and the proteins to be formed inside the host cell only. Then from that host cell, we can purify the protein, we can introduce the tag so that affinity chromatography can be applied and all different mechanisms can be applied to purify this particular protein of the gene of interest. So, such vectors are called as expression vectors, because what we are interested in is not to increase the copies of the gene, but we are interested in the product of that particular gene. We are interested in the protein of that particular gene. So, this in vitro transcription is giving you RNA that can be used for probes, etc. Then you can also express the gene of interest by using suitable expression vectors in suitable host, so that a lot of proteins is produced and, as I said, tags can be introduced so that they can be purified and then their actions can be or functions can be characterized. So, such kind of vectors are also very important which are there. So, this is just showing how this the promoter, for example, T7 promoter is there and you add T7 RNA polymerase and lot of RNA is formed because the transcription occurs through the gene of interest which is lying here. So, you can do the cloning as such, but the gene of interest is basically lying here. So, these are the plasmids that have been derived, these are the vectors that have been derived from E. coli plasmids and are of importance, and we basically emphasized on the fact that how they can be manipulated to give better attributes of being a cloning vector. So, talking about the cloning vectors based on M13 bacteriophages. So, E. coli plasmid derives cloning vector, we have seen a little genetic manipulation that can be done to make it a better and an ideal cloning vectors. And as I said, we just took certain examples to lay the foundation of how these naturally occurring plasmids become an ideal cloning vectors, what are their attributes, and we took certain examples to explain that. However, there are n number of vectors that are now being generated and that can be customized according to one's own use. Some of them are commercially available for different kind of functions, just for amplification of the gene of interest, for the expression, etc. And different kind of plasmids are there. So, we will also look at now cloning vectors based on the M13 bacteriophage. Now, M13 bacteriophage, the important feature that makes it attractive as the basis for the cloning vehicle is that the genome is less in size. It is less than 10 kb in size And therefore, again, you know, it is advantageous because we always talk about smaller the organism, the smaller the genome or the smaller the vector size, it is very important for the cloning thing. Then the double-stranded replicative form of the M13 genome behaves very much like a plasmid. It can be easily prepared from a culture of infected E. coli cells and can be reintroduced by transfection. So, the double-stranded replicative form, you know, it's just equivalent to plasmid what we talked about. The important aspect is now this plasmid can actually generate single-stranded DNA. So, most importantly, the genes closed within the M13 based vector can be obtained in the single-stranded form. So, the genome can actually replicate to form a double replicative form. The double replicative form, the genome of the M13 bacteriophage vector will act just like a plasmid. You can just digest them, ligate the gene of interest, you know, just like the manipulation which you do in the plasmid. But then it can be used to release the single stranded DNA form, which is again useful for, you know, acting as the sequencing primers or in vitro mutagenesis, etc. So, for these functional purposes, it is sometimes very important to get the single stranded form of DNA. For such genes of interest or sequences, it can be cloned on the M13 based vector. Now, M13 based vector are also used in phage display. We will skip this phage display for time being and take it over when we complete the bacteriophages vectors. But it is one of the important aspect of M13 vectors. This phage display is a technique for identifying pairs of genes whose protein products interact with one another. So, just remember that there are diverse functions for which M13 vectors are used. However, in detail, we will talk about this after finishing up with the cloning vectors of bacteriophages. So, this is the construction of M13 phage vectors. Now, we will talk about the series of M13 phage vectors that are developed. Now, M13, this is an M13 genome, and as you can see that the normal M13 genome is 6.4 kb, less than 10 kb in size, but most of this is taken up by 10 closely packed genes. Each are essential for the replication of the phage. So, you can see that this is the only sequence which is available for doing any kind of manipulation. This entire region is occupied by the genes which are important for the replication of the phage. So, you cannot do any kind of manipulation here because that will disrupt the replication of the phage. So, all you can do is you can introduce your gene of interest. So, the size is very much limited, and as you can see, it also contains the origin of replication. So, you can't even disturb this particular part. So, you are left with a very limited size where your gene of interest can be cloned. Now, how these are cloned is that one of the thing which they do is they introduce different kind of, you know, they do the same restriction digestion and introduce different clusters. For example, in this particular thing, they introduce the LacZ gene here. So, for the development of the first series of vectors, what they have introduced is a LacZ gene containing the cloning site, or basically LacZ gene has been introduced in here. Now, this LacZ gene, then, you know, in the next series, there was a manipulation where a mutagenesis, although this was a chance mutation that occurred, where you can create an EcoR1 site. So, this LacZ gene that was inserted now contained an EcoR1 site for the cloning purposes. So, this is the limited manipulations that is basically occurring and can be done for the development of the M13 phage vectors, which is, for example, this one and this particular vectors which is there. So, you can introduce the LacZ gene, as you can see there is a limited space, and this particular change that occurs because for the creation of the EcoR1 site, the EcoR1 site for the insertion of the genome was for the gene of interest was also created here. Then further what they did was that they created a polylinker. So, as you can see, a multiple cloning, an artificial multiple cloning site oligonucleotide fragment was generated, and it was flanked by the EcoR1 on both the sides. Now, this particular DNA fragment was then introduced into the EcoR1 site containing now. So, what it has was that in this limited space, it contains the LacZ for the recombinant selection, the insertional inactivation, blue-white screening, then it also contains a molylinker site. So, again, you can see that by manipulation of the genome, how we are trying to get a better and better vector. So we have introduced the LAC-C gene, they have introduced the restriction sites, the polylinker sites. You can see different kind of sites were introduced into this particular insert, again increasing the versatility of the manipulation for this particular genome that can be there. So these are EcoR1 EvoR hangs. So if you cut this genome with EcoR, you insert this, ligate this, you get this particular plasmid in which you have a LAC-Z containing a polylinker site, which is basically there. So, most sophisticated M13 vectors have more complex polylinkers. So, this is a very simple example where this kind of a polylinker has been introduced and the M13 genome is developed into this particular plasmid so that the vector manipulations can be done. However, most sophisticated M13 vectors have more complex polylinkers inserted into the delta LAC-Z gene. For example, M13MP8, which has the same series of restriction sites as the plasmid bucket. This is very important. Now, this polylinker site, you know, that has been introduced and to create this M13MP8 is the same as that is present in the plasmid PUC18. And what happens is, what is the significance of that is that the DNA cloned into a member of the PUC series can therefore be transferred directly to the M13MP counterpart, enabling the clone gene to be obtained as single-stranded DNA. So, what we need to do is that if we have already done the cloning to amplify a particular gene of interest in PUC series, we can directly cut it because it has the same cloning sites as this M13MP8, that it basically you can just cut it as you can see here. So, you can, you know, just shuttle the particular fragment from the PUC to the M13 containing vector. So, it contains the same sites, you digest it with EcoR BAMWatch, you take this particular plasmid M13 vector, you cut it with the same enzymes, you just introduced this particular gene of interest in here. So, you can actually shuttle a fragment from the PUC8 series directly into the M13MP8 series. Not necessarily, you know, every vector has the same kind of restriction site. So, sometimes you need to do manipulation. For example, if this has EcoR1 and BAMH1, it is cloned fragment here. This some vectors do not have BAMH1 site. So, you have to think of something else, or you have to add linkers, or there has to be, you know, additional manipulations that need to be done. But in such kind of developments, you can directly cut the insert from one particular plasmid and you can clone it directly into the other plasmids containing the similar sites. So, you can use this particular gene to create single-stranded DNA forms and clone it directly from the PUC series to the M13 series. So, such shuttle vectors are again very, so these are not shuttle vectors, this is shuttling of the DNA which is there. So, shuttling of the DNA fragment from one particular plasmid to the other plasmid in a very easy and simple manner. Now, coming to the fact that M13 phages because has this limited size of DNA interest, further manipulations were being done to create what are called as phagmids. Now, phagmids are hybrid plasmid M13 vectors. It combines the versatility of the plasmid and single-stranded DNA production of the M13 into a single vector. Now, one disadvantage of M13 vectors, as I have already stated, is a limit to the size of the DNA fragment that can be cloned, with 1500 base pairs generally being looked on as the maximum capacity, because that is the only gene of interest, you know, which is there, and that much only can be created. Because if you go over the size, then there will be a difficulty in the replication of it. It will not take up more than. So, this is the only limit, this is the only insert which is, you know, which can be manipulated to contain a gene of interest. So, what they did, what is basically done is that a number of hybrid vectors are then created, termed as phagmids, which have been developed by combining a part of the M13 genome and the plasmid DNA. So, what happens, for example, this particular vector PEMBL8 made by the transferring into PUC8 a 1300 base pair fragment of the M13 genome. So, you take a PUC8 molecule. So, we know that in PUC8 molecule, we have an ampicillin resistant gene, we have LAC-Z, we have the polylinker site, etcetera. And now, you introduce this 1300 base pair from the M13 genome. So, this 1300 base pair of M13 DNA fragment, this becomes a phagmid. And how it basically works is that the piece of M13 contains the signal sequence which is recognized by the enzymes that convert the PMBL8 molecules into single-stranded DNA and the secreted as the defective phage particles. So, what happens is if you have a gene of interest here, then because this replication machinery is going to replicate it into single sDNA, so you have all the versatility of the plasmid, you have the vector selection, you have a polylinker site, you can do a lot of manipulations on this much part to create an ideal cloning vector. And this particular addiction, although this is just a 1300 base pair part, it still contains the signal sequence which will cause the DNA polymerase to bind and create single stranded DNA fragments. So, this particular phagemid can give rise to single stranded. So, if our gene of interest is cloned here, it will also be produced as a single stranded DNA fragment which is there. So, these phagemids become again very important. All that is necessary is that the host E. coli cells are subsequently infected with normal M13 to act as a helper phage, providing the necessary replicative enzymes and phage coat proteins. So, what happens is that this particular gene of interest can replicate the phagemid to produce single stranded DNA molecule, however, will not result in the infective bacteriophages. So, for that what we need is the helper phage. So, once you have introduced your recombinant phagemid into a E. coli host, you infect it with a normal M13 so that it provides all the replicative enzymes and phage coat proteins so that the single stranded DNA are produced from the phagemids and then engulfed in the coat proteins and become a normal infective or a complete phage particle, M13 phage particle, which containing the single stranded DNA molecule, which can then be extracted and used for downstream applications. So, this becomes an important aspect and a necessary thing which is required. So, PMBL8 is being derived from PUC8. It has the polylinker cloning sites within the delta lag Z gene. So, recombinant plaques can be identified on agar containing XGAL. So, you know, blue-white screening can be applied here. So, the recombinant selection is there. So, it is giving all the versatility of a PUC8 molecule or PUC series molecule, so the plasmid molecule which is there, but with the single stranded versions of cloned DNA fragments up to 10 kb of length, it can be obtained, greatly extending the range of the M13 cloning system. So, phagemids are again a very important series of vectors that contain the functional abilities of the PUC system as well as the M13 cloning systems, greatly extending the diversity and the range of such systems that can be used. So, that was an important aspect of it. So, M13 based vectors are basically important for the single stranded DNA molecules, and manipulations and hybrids are generated to increase its efficiency as well as to enhance its diversity for the biotechnological applications that we are looking at. Now, talking about the cloning vectors based on the lambda bacteriophage, the third aspect for the session today. Now, there are two problems that had to be solved before lambda based cloning vectors could be developed. One important aspect is that the lambda DNA molecule, so lambda are again, you know, kind of bacteriophages. I am not going into detail of the molecular biology, which we have discussed in our different molecular biology sessions. The lambda bacteriophage can have a lytic and a lysogenic cycle. It infects the bacteria, its DNA can be integrated into the host genome and remain there as in the lysogenic phase, or the more infected particles can be created and it can come out. It can disrupt the bacteria and more infected particles can be released so that it can again infect more molecules, more bacteria to replicate itself. So, these lambda DNA molecules, now this lambda genome, if we do certain manipulations, then ideal cloning vectors can be generated. The lambda DNA molecule, why we need to harness the capability of lambda bacteriophage, because it can, as we will see, take up larger DNA fragments. For plasmids, we are looking at something like 5 to 6 kb DNA fragments, which are stable. For M13 bacteriophages, the main purpose was to generate a single stranded DNA molecules. Again, the capacity was related to 5 to 10 kb DNA gene of interest, which was there. In bacteriophages, we will see that certain kind of bacteriophages can take up to 25 kb, 9 to 23 kb of gene of interest. So, if we need to clone larger fragments, we need to have a high capacity vectors. So, lambda bacteriophages can be manipulated to create such kind of cloning vectors. Now, what are the shortcomings which we will address to make it as a better cloning vector? One of the thing is that the lambda DNA molecule can be increased in size by only about 5%, representing the addition of only 3 kb of new DNA. Now, we want to harness the different capability of bacteriophages, as we will see, but the amount of DNA it can just take is 3 kb, which is less than even the simpler plasmids. So, it just can take 3 kb, not much suitable for us. So, we will manipulate it so that it can take larger DNA. So, this was one of the limitation which was there. So, you can see that this particular molecule, if it contains a larger fragment, then no bacteriophages or the prophages will be generated. For the functional or infective molecules to be generated, the size should be lesser. So, the possibility is that only 3 kb of gene of interest can be introduced into it. Second disadvantage is that the lambda genome is so large that it has more than one recognition sequence for virtually every restriction endonucleases. We have been talking about multiple cloning sites, we have been talking about polylinkers, and we have been and that is basically the unique restriction sites which are there so that we can clone, which is not present in the rest of the plasmid, so that we can digest it, linearize it, and introduce our gene of interest into the plasmid vector. Now, because the lambda genome is too large, if we use it as a vector, then it practically contains many recognition sites for virtually every restriction endonuclease. So, for example, if you want to use EcoR1 for digesting the lambda genome, there will be 100 of EcoR1 sites which are present in the lambda genomes, and therefore, you will get 100 shorter fragments which are there. So, there will be a lot of complexity which will be there for the recombinant molecules or genomes to be generated. So, this is again a very large disadvantage. So, you can see here. So, they have contained multiple sites. If you cut it with that, you will get a lot of different fragments which are there. So, these different fragments will create complexity for the cloning of the gene of interest. So, these two were the disadvantages. Although we were looking at, so we need to manipulate the lambda genome. There are certain aspects, for example, the introduction of lambda genome into the host or its selection or the kind of replication it occurs so that we can increase the number of cloned fragments faster. These bacteriophages has advantages, but we need to manipulate these two aspects so that it can become an ideal cloning vector. So, what we did, what is basically done is that the segments of the lambda genome can be deleted without impairing viability. So, what was found was that this intergenic region, this region which is enclosed within these arrows, if you remove this thing, then the viability of the bacteriophage is not removed. So, you kind of shorten the size of the genome so that this particular gene of interest, this particular fragment can be actually removed, and therefore, the genome size will become lower, and because the genome size will become lower, it will be able to take up the larger DNA fragments. So, where it was taking just 3 kb DNA fragment, if you remove this particular fragment from the genome of the bacteriophage, lambda bacteriophage, it is able to take up 18 kb of gene of interest and still produce infective functional bacteriophage particles. So, the basic thing is that when you introduce the gene of interest into the lambda bacteriophage genome, what we want is that still it will be able to replicate this genome, package it into protein capsids, and then become functional so that it can cause the lysis of the cell and be released outside. Therefore, the number of molecules can infect further and replicate further. So, if you remove this particular intergenic fragment, then the 18 kb fragments of gene of interest can be cloned here without impairing the viability of the bacteriophage. Removal of all or part of this non-essential region decreases the size of the resulting lambda molecule by up to 15 kb. So as much as 18 kb of new DNA can now be added before the cutoff point for packaging, before the packaging is reached. So before the packaging is reached, you can introduce it here. So this is one of the manipulation which is very advantageous to increase the size of the gene of interest that can be introduced into a lambda bacteriophage. The non-essential region, what it contains is most of the genes involved in integration and excision of the prophage from the E. coli chromosome. So if you can go back to the infective cycle of the lambda bacteriophages, then this integration and excision of the prophage, this is basically for the lysogenic cycle. If this non-essential region containing these genes is removed, then the deleted genome is therefore non-lysogenic and can only follow the lytic infection. So, lytic infection is again very advantageous for us because our clone DNA fragment will be packaged along with the genome of the lambda bacteriophage into the protein capsids. More infective particles will be formed, it will lyse the bacterial host and will be released to infect more bacterial host, causing the formation of more of the bacteriophages containing agar recombinant genome, containing the recombinant genome. So, the lytic infection is very much advantageous for the cloning purposes. So, this particular removal gives an additional advantage that it converts from a lysogenic to a lytic infection cycle which is there. This is itself is desirable for a cloning vector as it means induction is not needed before the plaques are formed. So, if you remember, the plaques is basically we are talking about when the bacterial lawn is there and we introduce the infective particles. So, it will infect the bacteria and clear and create a kind of a clearer region on the plates. So, these are the visible forms where we can see that the bacteriophage has infected the bacteria and therefore lysed the cells leading to the formation of the plaques which is there. Then another important aspect is that the natural selection can be used to isolate the modified lambda that lack certain restriction sites. So, this is again advantageous for us which happened that there was a natural selection that can be used to isolate the modified lambda. So, there was a natural. So, what they did was that so that limiting the size was addressed. Now, moving of the different restriction enzyme sites, what they did was that they did a natural selection. They introduced the bacteriophage into an E. coli host that produces the ampicillin, that produces the EcoR1 restriction enzymes. So, that it will kill all the bacteriophage because it has got multiple number of EcoR1 sites, and when the genome is fragmented, it is very difficult to replicate and then form the infective particles. So, most of the bacteriophages will die because it contains EcoR1 sites, but there can be certain mutations disrupting the EcoR1 sites, natural mutations, spontaneous mutations that can occur. So, one or more restriction enzymes can be restriction enzyme sites can be disrupted. So, you can naturally select those particular mutated bacteriophages in which EcoR1 sites. So, initial one probably one or two has been disrupted, and if you do this process continuously, then you are going to harbor or you are going to enrich the presence of those bacteriophages, and you will ultimately get those mutant variety of bacteriophages which do not contain EcoR1 sites at all. So, that EcoR1 site then become unique if you introduce into a polylinker site because rest of the genome does not contain the EcoR1 site. So, this kind of natural selection can also be used to isolate the modified lambda that lack certain restriction sites which are there. So, talking about all these different attributes and genetic manipulations, we can again increase the different kind of versatility and the characteristics of lambda bacteriophage genome to be used as the ideal cloning vectors also. So, in our subsequent sessions, so today we have talked about the E. coli derived plasmids, we have talked about the M13 plasmids for single stranded DNA production, and we have also touched upon the lambda bacteriophage vectors. We have talked about that how the basic lambda bacteriophage genome can be manipulated to give rise to the ideal cloning vectors. In our subsequent sections, we will talk about the different lambda bacteriophage vectors in detail.